We are joining you from our Naturalist Center today. And today we are going to be talking about snakes. We have four snakes here at the museum, and they are all non-venomous. And so there are actually only six venomous species of snakes here in Florida, and we have a total of over 300 different types of species of snakes in total. So it's very rare that you'll come across a venomous snake. However, when I'm out hiking, I always practice safe social distancing from any wildlife, especially snakes. And another thing we wanted to let you know, if you have any questions during the live stream about anything we're talking about, feel free to leave a question in the comments and we will get to your questions. So we're going to start off with defining what is a snake. So a snake is a legless reptile with scales, a short tail, and no eyelids. The no eyelids part is kind of important because we have legless lizards, but those legless lizards have longer tails and they actually have eyelids. So those are how you can tell the difference between a snake and a legless lizard. And so next thing we're gonna talk about is how they move. So snakes don't have legs, so how do they move? Well, if you put your hands on your rib cage like this, you will notice you feel your ribs, and if you move like this, you can feel your ribs and your ab muscles go up and down, and that's sort of how a snake moves. They also have special scales on their bellies called ventral scales that are longer and cover one end to the other, and that's what sort of helps them grip onto the ground so they can move more easily. And I want to jump back to sort of what a snake is. They're reptiles, right? And that means they're ectotherms. What's an ectotherm? Well, that means they're cold-blooded. That doesn't mean the blood running through their veins is cold. That just means that the temperature of the air around them is the same temperature as their body. So that's why if you come to the museum and you walk in the Florida Naturalist Center, you will notice a significant temperature difference from the outside of the room to the inside of the room. In this space, it's about 78 degrees, which is kind of warm for us humans, but it's a little bit better for our reptiles, including our snakes. And in all of their enclosures, in order to keep their body temperature at the correct level, which is typically around 80 to 90 degrees. In these spaces, we have heat lamps and UV bulbs, and these bulbs actually sort of mimic natural sunlight and heat that they would get out in the wild. All right. And so another thing that is really cool about snakes is how they smell. So if you ever see a snake licking its tongue, you might notice that it is forked. It's got a little V. And this is actually how they smell. They smell with their tongue, which is crazy. For us humans, our sense of smell is sort of directed towards our nose and our sense of taste. Those two things are connected. So you can think of snakes as tasting the air in order for them to smell. So what happens is they are, you know, flicking their tongue around, they're collecting air particles on the tips of their tongue, then they're bringing their tongue back into their mouth, and they have a special organ in the back of their throat called the Jacobson's organ, and this sort of translates those air particles into smell, which is how they know where their food is. They don't have the best eyesight, but they do sort of know their direction from the way their tongue is, which is pretty cool. So I think that's pretty much everything about what a snake is. And so we have our other naturalist, Elijah, here, and he's going to introduce you to our youngest, cutest snake named Archie.
Hello, everyone. Again, my name is Elijah, and I have our youngest snake, Archie, here, so you can get a better view of him. Archie is less than a year old. Maybe he just hit his 1 year. He is in our session from last year. He was actually a wild caught, and he was thought to be a venomous snake. They thought he was venomous because of his dark coloration. which kind of match of a juvenile cotton mouth. But he is a banded water snake, so he was donated here to the museum. So he is fresh out of his enclosure. This is his enclosure behind me. He is called the water snake, but he doesn't really live in the water. Instead, he likes to live in dirt areas, and he will try to bask above the water. There he goes. So he is different from most snakes. Some snakes are called constricting snakes, and they're able to wrap around like this. Other snakes are called striker snakes, and you'll meet one of them soon. But Archie here, his diet mostly consists of fish. He eats small minnows or rosies or small goldfish. When he gets bigger, in about 2 years, will change his diet to be more frog-based, some salamanders, some more amphibian, because he'll be more bigger. One key difference between him and a cottonmouth, if you look at his eyes are more roundish. Cottonmouth's eyes are kind of like a cat eye. They're straight and vertical. So cute. As you can see, he is not biting me, he is smelling me, like what Robin's saying. He is using his tongue and he's seeing if there's any food around. He is very calm right now. When he is older, his colorations will darken and he'll look more black-based, which is kind of like a cottonmouth. That's why they get confused a lot. He's here in our collections because we want to show all the different kinds of animals and all the different kinds of snakes and how most of them are non-venomous and they're safe to have around your pond or your lake or any place like that. And remember guys, if you have any questions, feel free to put them in the comments and one of us naturalists will answer them. A little bit more about Archie. He can grow to be around 2 to 4 feet long. So as you can see, he's roughly around 6 inches, so he has a lot of growing to do. We don't know his exact sex, so we don't know if he's a male or a female, but we do know that he gives live birth, kind of like what a mammal does. So he'll hold the egg, or she will hold the eggs inside of her, and then she will emit the snakes out of her body, which is pretty interesting. Most reptiles would just lay eggs instead. And that's pretty much it about Archie. Carlisle will be the next snake you meet, and he will be with Robin. And Carlisle is an eastern indigo snake, so stay tuned.
Snakes can get overweight very easily if you overfeed them. purses and belts and shoes all out of their scales. But now we've realized that they are very important to our ecosystem. They are natural rodent propellants. Basically, they eat rodents and other small mammals that could be considered pests for us, like rats and things. And they also live with gopher tortoises. So as I mentioned in another video with our gopher tortoises dig these burrows and house a lot of different types of animals in these burrows, including eastern indigo snakes. I always say that gopher tortoises, burrows are the club, and eastern indigo snakes are bouncer to club gopher tortoise. Because they're really big and they eat a lot of the animals that tend to eat gopher tortoise eggs. So that's pretty much everything about Carlisle. He's really awesome and he'd love to meet you when you come to MOSH. And looks like Elijah has Arthur to show you guys, so go ahead.
Evan, it's me again, and I brought another species of snake. He is called a Florida king snake, and king snakes are one of my favorite kinds of snakes. So this is one of the kind of constrictor snakes that I mentioned before, and as you can see, he's very explorative. He would like to know what's around me. King snakes are called king snakes for one specific reason. They're basically the kings of all snakes. The reason why they're called the king snakes is because they're immune to venomous snakes, especially venomous snakes that live with them too. So if this guy went up, let's say with a cottonmouth or another kind of venomous snake, he would most likely win because the venom will not affect him as much as it would affect us. That's why these kinds of snakes are really good to keep around your house and your property, because they not only are rodent control, but they make sure all the venomous animals are gone too. He is around 11 years old, so he's younger than Carlisle, but he is a well-built boy. As you can see, he's very big, he's very long, and he's very healthy, because he's very energetic right now. This kind of coloration is the yellow coloration that can be found further south of Florida, so it's most common in Miami. Up here in Jacksonville, we'll mostly see some red color, black color, some of the darker tones. And then up north in America are the queen snakes, which are pretty cool. They're the same thing, they're immune to venomous snakes as well. They just are called queen snakes. Not all king snakes are males, and not all queen snakes are females. It's just what they're called. And his diet consists of some large mice. He is a big boy, so he needs to have his good protein. All of our snakes only eat one mice, and they eat one time a week. So we try to keep them on a good diet like that. You can tell he is wrapping around my hand. That is what a constricting snake does. He's constricting to give himself support. He would do this to climb up trees. He'll do this to wrap around his food so he can't escape. This is how they hunt too. Most people think constricting snakes will crush their food before they eat it, but all they do is they wrap around just so they can't get up. And a little graphic detail is they would squeeze little bit by little bit just so the animal would eventually fall asleep, so it's easier for them to swallow.
So we have a couple questions. What would happen if one of these snakes bit you?
So all of our snakes here, unlike a venomous snakes have really long fangs, and that's how they put the venom inside of you. These snakes have really small razor sharp teeth on the cross of their mouth. That's how they hold the food. And if these snakes were to bite us, we would bleed because their teeth are really sharp, but they would eventually let go. Yeah. And a good way, something I learned too, if a snake is biting you and it's holding on really tight, you can put hand sanitizer or vinegar around the biting part, and they would pretty much let go. They don't like the smell of that. So it's a good thing to keep a spray bottle of that around if you're handling snakes.
How long do snakes live?
That depends on the species of snakes. Some snakes can live to be only 8 years old, and there's other snakes that can live to be around 30 to 40 years old. And also, if you have a domestic snake, they live longer than it is in the wild. Perfect. I think that's all I have for Arthur here. I'm going to let him walk around. I might put him on the AstroTurf if you want to see him walk around as well. He is our only king snake now, and he is my favorite snake we have. We take him outside so he gets his natural sunlight, and I let him go in between the dirt and the leaves just so he has some natural enrichments. There has been a case where one of our snakes did got out of their enclosure, but she left her house so much she was just sleeping underneath her house. It was really cute. None of our snakes have escaped and been gone. We take really good care of all of our snakes, and as you can see, he's really healthy. A good way to know if a snake is overweight or underweight is to looking at their scales. Most snake scales are lined up like shingles on a roof, so it's one above the other. And that's why whenever you come to MOSH and we do touching, when that resumes, you want to go down his body. Because if you go up, it's kind of like you're pulling on someone's hair. It really hurts them.
And you said he eats once a week?
Yeah, he eats once a week. We try to give him around 20 grams a week, too.
Take our snakes outside to get natural sunlight. We bring out a stick for them to climb. They get very mobile, very happy looking. So we love to do enrichment with our snakes. Yep. And do we have any other questions?
How many snakes are here?
We have 4 non-venomous species of snakes here. We have 3 constrictors and 1 striker. So Bella is considered a constrictor. Arthur is considered a restrictor. Archie is considered a just a water snake. And then Carlisle is considered a striker. Now, as Elijah mentioned, constrictors tend to squeeze, but strikers like Carlisle tend to attack with their mouth first and then use their sheer body weight to crush their prey, and then they will eat.
Favorite questions I get asked whenever I'm doing programs is where does their tail start and their neck start? So we said that they have a really small tail, and their tail you can tell by the different kinds of scutes. So their tail actually starts right here. You can tell because these are smaller scutes and these are more wider scutes. Or scales. I'm sorry, I'm saying scutes. And then over here, his neck, it's harder to tell, but it is around the second notch. So as you can see, he's moving around, but it's right here is where his neck will end. And that's kind of like that for every kind of snake.
Ooh, do you know how many teeth a snake has?
I do not know how many teeth a snake has, unfortunately. I can quickly look that up, and we can continue talking about that.
Yeah, so snakes have really cool teeth, and the way they eat is actually pretty amazing. So if you feel your chin right here, you'll notice there's a little divot, and that's where our 2 jaw muscle or jaw bones are connected and fused. However, on a snake, their 2 jaw bones are not fused together. And so when they eat, they can actually eat things that are twice the circumference of their body. So say Bella can probably eat a mouse that is maybe about that big and about that wide. But in order to get that mouse into her tiny little mouth, she has to open her mouth as wide as she can, and then the bottom of her jaw actually opens up. And then they use their C-shaped teeth to sort of drag or move the food into their body. Which is really cool. And snakes have elongated organs. So their stomach is really long. And it's really cool to watch a snake eat because you can see where the food is and how it's being moved through their body. It's actually really amazing, and I highly recommend watching some videos on how snakes eat. Or if you come to the museum during a feeding day, it's really fun to watch Carlisle eat because he's very active, he's very food motivated, and we actually hide his food in a box. So he has to actually find his food when we put it in there, which is really fun. Yeah.
And while we're waiting on the answer to the teeth question, how often do snakes shed their skin?
That's a very good question. And honestly, it depends on the snake. Bella here sheds her skin every 2 months. Carlisle sheds his skin every 2 months. So average about 2 months for our snakes here at the museum, but of course it just depends on the snake. And how do they do this? I'll go into a little bit more detail. So what happens is there is a fluid that begins to build up between their old skin and their new skin. And we can tell they're about to shed because their eyes will start to be very cloudy. Now with Carlisle, it's a little difficult because his eyes are already cloudy, but then we turn to their bellies. If their bellies are sort of getting opaque or more white in color, that means they're starting their shed cycle. And they shed their skin from the tip of their nose to the tip of their tail, including their eyelids. Now remember I said they didn't have eyelids, and their eyelids are actually a clear scale that goes over their eye, and they shed that too. They are called eye caps. And so throughout the process so the shed will come off all in one piece. And usually when we have a shed that isn't all in one piece for multiple shed cycles, we usually contact the vet because that might be a sign that another health issue is happening.
And to answer the question of how many teeth do snakes have, it differs between snakes, but the four snakes we have here have roughly around 50 teeth, and they have a total of four rows, two on the top and two on the bottom. Venomous snakes mostly rely on their two fangs they have. They don't really have many rows of teeth. Yeah, so that is what I found out real quick. But so again, it would hurt if these snakes did bite us. But of course, as long as we take care of them and they don't feel like they're in any threat, they have no reason to bite us. My rule is, why would you bite the hand that feeds you? Bitch.
Yep. And to add to that, as staff, we take full precautions when right before we handle a snake, if we have held another animal or if we handle mice or anything, we wash our hands and pretty much up to our elbows with soap and warm water. We dry our hands out. And our snakes know what we smell like. We handle them almost every day, and so they know what our skin naturally smells like after we wash our hands and arms. So that's another reason why they wouldn't typically bite us unless they feel threatened or hurt or something like that. But of course, they don't ever feel that way here at MOSH. And I think that's pretty much everything we can say about snakes today. Of course, if you have any other questions, feel free to leave them in the comments, and we will get back to you as soon as we can. But thank you so much for tuning in. Check out all of our other videos on MOSH Connect. You can check them out at themosh.org and go to the Connect tab, and all of our videos will be up there. We have videos on gopher tortoises, our birds, and our courtyard, talking about plants. So thank you all for tuning in, and have a wonderful rest of your day.